The story of Abraham and Sarah is a story about strangers in a strange land. They were in a land without protection, without connections, and they had to carry on in spite of the harassment. But they're not alone. There are so many people that find themselves as strangers in a strange land today. How should we respond to them? How can we rise above the fear that would paralyze us or cause us to build barriers to separate us from such individuals? How can we open up our hearts and minds and truly be a people that will trust God and obey the Word of God? Let's go to Him right now in prayer. Father God, we're coming to You right now. We're asking that You would help us to be a people of compassion, with hospitality flowing from our hearts, that we could rise above fear, Lord God. And Lord, our response to those that are in need around us will not be, Lord God, a result of this political pressure or that which is socially acceptable. But Lord, what does Your Word tell us to do? Give us a holy boldness in Jesus' name. Amen. The story of Abraham and Sarah is a story of homelessness that is repeated time and time again. So many are now hurting. So many are in need. So many find themselves oppressed. Regardless of whatever political party may be in power, whether it's the Democrats in St. Louis, where we see the homeless harassed and can't even be in the parks after 10 o'clock at night, a city totally controlled by the Democrats, or whether it's in Washington, D.C., which Republicans control. It goes far beyond political barriers or political parties. And so instead of being interpreted by whatever those parties say, let's see what God's Word has to say. And may He give us the holy boldness to do what Jesus told us to do. When I was hungry, did You feed me? Naked, did You clothe me? Sick or in prison, did You visit me? A stranger, did You welcome me? Strangers in a strange land. Now, if we're going to study the Word of God, it can't be like it's some kind of spiritual smorgasbord where we pick a little of that and pick a little of this and eat a little of this and ignore the other stuff out there. As one person told me yesterday, man, if it's healthy, I don't want it. Well, that's the way it is. The unhealthy stuff might taste so good and look so palatable, and it's so easy to go along with the crowd, whether it's the spiritual stuff or whether it's the food stuff. But let's get into God's Word and let's see what it was. Abraham and Sarah were in Egypt without permission. They were there, and they were obeying God. They were moving through that particular area, and they're strangers in a strange land. They're like many who suddenly find themselves homeless, and they're in the parks and the vacant lots, and like Abraham and Sarah, who brought blessings to wherever they were at. Immigrants coming into this country can bring the blessings of abundant labor. They can help us to understand other cultures as poverty drives them across the border. What does God's Word have to say about that? You know, the golden rule for many people is to him who's got the gold makes the rules, but that's not what God's Word has to say. And when we turn to Exodus 23, verse 9, when it comes to the homeless and the migrants, it says, "You shall not oppress a stranger. You know the heart of a stranger, for you were strangers in the land of Egypt." And how true that could be to each one of us whose families go back a few generations, came from another country to this country. And they were received in this country and they were given opportunities. And that's what so many right now are trying to get and often paying a great price for such. Recently, a father and his daughter were found embracing each other outside of Matamoros as they swam across this river, just trying to, the Rio Grande River, trying to have a new beginning. They were tired of waiting on the lists in Matamoros outside of Brownsville. Until finally, out of despair, they just decided to try to swim across the river, and they both died, locked in each other's arms. Story after story could be told about this. The whole border issue is a very complex issue. There's no easy answer. But as believers, we need to be propelled, like Joyce and others that I've met, to go into the bus stations and like they're doing in Harlingen, Texas, and as the people are processed and they're put on the buses and sent to their relatives, they go in and welcome them, and they take water to them, and it's such a privilege. I had an opportunity to do that and to share the love of Christ, and the people are so gracious and the children are so thankful. Now, some might find that appalling. They want to, because discrimination has swept over our community, and it's just really so sad. And this perhaps could be reflected in a quote that I read in July of 2019 in Time Magazine. That was one of the envoys, one of the individuals who was on the envoy of the United States UN High Commission of Refugees, said this: at the first sign of armed conflict or persecution, the natural human response is to take your children out of harm's way. Threatened by bombs, mass rape, or murder squads, people gather the little they can and carry and seek safety. Refugees are people who've chosen to leave a conflict. They pull themselves and their families through war and often help rebuild their countries. These are qualities to be admired. Why then has the word refugee acquired such negative connotations in our time? Why are politicians being elected on promises to shut borders and turn back refugees? Today, the distinction between refugees and migrants have been blurred and politicalized. Refugees have been forced to flee their country because of persecution, war, or violence. Migrants have chosen to move mainly to improve their lives. Some leaders deliberately use the term refugee and migrant interchangeably, using hostile rhetoric that whips up fear among all outsiders. Everyone deserves dignity and fair treatment, but we need to be clear about the distinction. Under international law, it's not an option to assist refugees, it's an obligation. It is perfectly possible to ensure strong border control and fair and humane immigration policies while meeting our responsibility to help refugees. More than half of all refugees worldwide are children, and 4 of 5 of them live in a country that borders the conflict or the crisis they have fled. This quote by Angelina Jolie is not only one that she expresses and is not only international law, but is straight from God's word: to love the stranger who find themselves in a strange land. The tragedy of all this is as Christians deny what the Word of God says and align themselves with certain political parties because somehow in their mind they've interpreted that that party is a better Christian than the other party, violates all the principles of love and evangelism and what Christ has called us to do, and that is to put Jesus Christ first in our lives, to let Jesus be Lord of our lives. Meaning we'll march to a different drumbeat frequently, we'll directly oppose those principles, whether it's on a local level that make it so difficult for homeless people to survive, or on a national level. We're going to seek to do God's will and seek to serve Him in every respect. I know of countless numbers of hurting and homeless people who are desperate, and often out of their desperation, like Abraham and Sarah, they might find themselves breaking minor laws. They might actually climb on a metro bus without a ticket because they have to get to this doctor appointment. They just don't have it. They may actually find themselves sleeping in a park after 10 o'clock at night when it says nobody's supposed to be in this park. And the police come and say, move, and they say, where? And they can't get into these shelters. They might find themselves using the bathroom even because they don't allow porta potties out there, and then they can be fined up to $100, and even if they've caught 3 times like this, listed as a sex offender. I mean, all these laws are set up by people that have homes, people that have money, and are totally out of touch with what Jesus referred to as the least of these. The world system works like this, that federal funds are channeled through municipalities, and then those agencies that get the money from these municipalities remain totally silent, as those municipalities make all kinds of laws that would do everything they can to keep the homeless out of sight, out of mind. For example, they won't even let people do what Scripture tells them to do when it comes to housing their own children, because they said there's only a certain number of people can be in this area and they're not on the city register. So parents can't even take their own children in it in frequently cases. Churches that want to open up their doors find themselves in direct conflict with local municipal laws. And then when they try to abide by the law, rich folks move into a particular neighborhood and then they'll shut down a shelter like they did the New Life Evangelistic Center in 2017 at 1411 Locust Street. The battle continues. So living out the gospel of hospitality is becoming increasingly difficult. And we see this taking place today as the war on poverty has become the war on the impoverished. The fact of the matter is are we going to be the Christians Christ has called us to be? And it's impossible to be a Christian without following Christ. There's so much being done today. And the slickness of the political parties that will take on a couple of issues that maybe is close to the heart of the Christian, maybe even put a couple of Supreme Court justices in power, and then totally deny all the other principles when it comes to morality. our justice, our hospitality to the homeless and hurting. When Jesus said, when I was hungry, did you feed me? Naked, did you clothe me? A stranger, he said, did you welcome me? He didn't expect him to give him excuses because city laws forbid it. When we provide housing to women and children in cities like St. Louis, unless you are zoned for a boarding house, you'd be violating the law. When you want to shelter your own children, as I indicated, they can make laws against that. And so what do? We have to be willing to seek Christ. And as the early apostles said in Acts chapter 5, verse 21, must be willing to obey God rather than men. When the scripture says, do the stranger, the homeless, no wrong, and the police tell the homeless, you can't sleep in the parks, you can't sleep here, you can't sleep there. So the homeless are subjected to the torture of sleep deprivation. When Jesus said, when I was hungry, did you feed me? And you take sandwiches out to the street. Often local municipalities say, no, you can't feed them out there because it's a safety issue. It wasn't prepared in a city-approved kitchen. Well, is it better for them to eat out of the dumpster or to go hungry? That's a better safety issue. Their thinking becomes so perverted. And many churches will leave the homeless outside because they don't want to upset the neighbors. They don't want to violate city codes. Maurice Harris, a rabbi at Temple Beth Israel in Eugene, Oregon, writes, laws are important and our country is based on the rule of law. Jewish tradition also sees laws as sacred and essential to a just society. But alongside law, Judaism also places sacred emphasis on story. The law must listen to the specifics of the stories being brought about. A good law is not robotic. It responds to people and it recognizes human vulnerability. It resists humiliating people who are swept along by massive forces that put them in a position of needing to take unappealing and dangerous risks to try to help themselves and their family survive. Leviticus 19:23 and 24 says very clearly, and if a stranger dwells with you in your land, you should do him or her no harm. The stranger that dwells with you should be to you as a home barn among you, and you should love him as yourself, for you were strangers in the land of Egypt. I am the Eternal, your God. So it comes down to us. Are you a Christian first? Are you a Republican first? Are you a Democrat first? Or is Jesus Christ Lord of your life? Are you going to take a stand because it's politically acceptable? Are you going to follow the scriptures? And God is very specific on the scriptures when it comes to helping the strangers in a strange land. The question each one of us must ask ourselves is, am I a Christian? And often we'd say, yes, I'm going to die and go to heaven. I believe in Jesus. Do you really believe in Jesus Christ? Is he Lord of your life? Or is the president Lord of your life? The mayor Lord of your life? Someone else the Lord of your life? If Jesus Christ is Lord of your life, then you're going to follow him, even when it's not acceptable with whatever political circle that you're in. Jesus said, not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, shall enter the kingdom of God, but who does the will of my Father that's in heaven. He said, when I was hungry, did you feed me? Naked, did you clothe me? Sick or in prison, visit me? A stranger, homeless, did you welcome me? That means welcoming the homeless, the refugee, and the immigrants to our country. Well, he also makes various promises for those who are kind to the poor and needy. He says in Proverbs 19, verse 17, he or she who is kind to the poor lends to the Lord, and he will reward him for what he has done. Proverbs 14, 21 goes on and points out that to despise our homeless neighbor is sinful, but kindness to them results in blessings. And he says, he who despises his neighbor sins, but blessed is he who is kind to the needy. In Psalm 41:1, we read, blessed is he or she that considereth the poor, the Lord will deliver them in time of trouble. To consider the poor means to engage in mountain moving faith in behalf of those who are in need. And this is something God has really laid on my heart lately, because I'm seeing these terrible needs, the hurting and the poor and the needy, whether it's the immigrant, the refugee, and the homeless right in our own community. I'm seeing the politicians and the media ignoring the homeless that we see in our streets. And what can I do? I can pray. And then I can be open to listening to God. And if he says, do this, I got to do it. But he makes it very clear in Mark chapter 11, verses 22 through 25, when he says, "Have faith in God, I tell you the truth. If anyone says to this mountain, 'Go throw yourself in the sea,' and does not doubt in his heart, but believes that what he says will happen and be done for him. Therefore, I tell you, whatever you ask for in prayer, believe that you've received it and it'll be yours. And when you stand praying, if you hold anything against anyone, forgive him, so that your Father in heaven may also forgive you your sins." As I hear the stories of those who are just so desperate that they want a new beginning, that they'll risk their lives swimming across a river, like the River Andy River, and losing their life. Like I mentioned, the father and the daughter who died embracing each other, they had drowned in desperation swimming across, and they wanted a new beginning. It's easy to get bitter against those policies that does such. But when I see the harassment of the least of these, the poor and needy, and like the woman who was along with about 20 other homeless people sleeping outside a St. Patrick's Center because they couldn't get in, and the city shutting down 1411 Locust. It's in St. Louis. It's so easy for one to get bitter in the midst of all that. Yet God hasn't called us to become bitter. He's called us to become better. And if we let unforgiveness flow in us, we're not going to be able to hear him when we're praying, "Lord, what do you want me to do in this case at this particular moment?" So Jesus tells us, and so each one of us need to be doing this, feeling what the homeless are feeling, feeling the hurt, the pain, and falling on our knees, as Matthew 7 and 8 says, "Ask and be given you, seek and you'll find, knock and it shall be opened unto you. For everyone who asks receives, and he who seeks finds, and to him who knocks the door will be open." I have a small mat that I laid on the wooden floor beside my bed. Every time I get into bed, I see that mat, that little piece of carpet, and it reminds me to get on my knees and pray for the fatherless, the widow, the hurting, the homeless, the needs of the New Life Evangelistic Center, the prayers for dedicated labors for the harvest, for family, for friends, to get on my knees and pray, whether it's when I go to bed at night or whether when I get up in the morning. Just a reminder, a piece of carpet on a hardwood floor, to fall on my knees and bring these needs before my Heavenly Father. And when you pray for the hurting, the homeless, the handicapped, the refugee, the migrant, you know that you're praying according to God's will, and that he answers prayer. Whatever two or three agree on earth, he says, it's agreed upon in heaven. Ask and it shall be given you. Seek and you shall find. Knock and it shall be opened unto you. That's what he's told us so clearly. The fact is, God hears and answers prayer. Whether for the prayers of others or other major needs in our own family and friends, God hears. As Psalm 34, 4 through 6 tells us, "I sought the Lord and he answered me. He delivered me from all my fears. Those who look to him are radiant. Their faces are never covered with shame. This poor man called, and the Lord heard him. He saved him out of all of his troubles." The central message of the Christian gospel involves compassion for the poor. Bishop George Douglas McKinney reminds us that Christ modeled a life, he says, and ministry of compassion to the poor. He was forever mingling with them, as we're told in Luke chapter 5, verses 1 through 11. He was eating with them, as Luke chapter 5, 27 to 32 brings out. He's confronting them, as Luke chapter 12, verse 22 to 34 says. He was feeding them, as Luke chapter 9, verse 10 to 17 brings out. And he was restoring them to health, as Luke chapter 17, verse 18 to 23 says. He even went so far as to use the dramatic words of Isaiah to summarize his life purposes when he said in Luke chapter 4, verse 18 through 19, "The Spirit of the Lord is on me because he has anointed me to preach the good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim freedom for the prisoners and recovery of sight for the blind, to release the oppressed and proclaim the year of the Lord's favor." Now, since John 1, 3 through 18 tells us, "Let us not love with words or tongue, but with action and truth," we as believers in the power of God are willing to stand up and confront the injustices of a society that won't even allow porta potties to be put like in the downtown areas, and will fine the homeless who go to the bathroom $100. And the scripture makes it clear in Deuteronomy 23, verse 12, where it says that they're supposed to have public latrines, how they're supposed to keep the camp clean, how they're supposed to have these places for the people. And yet they don't allow them. We've tried putting them in various places in downtown. They won't allow them to go up. But yet they'll come around and find the people and harass them when they have to carry out this normal body function. It's important that we are willing to obey the mandates of Scripture, as Psalm 82:3 says, to defend the poor and the fatherless and do justice to the afflicted and the needy. And so I cry out to God, show me, Lord, what you want me to do. Realize that the laws are made for the benefits of the rich who've hired their lawmakers and have actually bought them off to unlimited political contributions. In spite of what Isaiah chapter 10, verse 1 through 4 says, woe to them that decree unrighteous decrees and then write grievous what they've prescribed to turn aside the needy from judgment, take away their right from the poor of my people, that widows may be their prey and that they may rob the fatherless. Why do those who say that they're going to follow the mandates of Scripture remain silent and don't really even see that there's a refuge set up for the homeless where they could have 1 acre of ground, 1 acre of ground that they could build their own little community at? Instead, they're harassed and pushed from place to place to place. Doesn't Isaiah 1:17 says, learn to do good, seek justice, correct oppression, defend the fatherless, and plead the cause of the widow? God's heart has always been with the oppressed, the hurting, and the homeless. He's with those who cry out for deliverance day and night. He cries. He's with those who are hungry, and they don't get the food that they need, who rest, who are strangers in a strange land. We see this. God's record of compassion is clearly throughout the history of the Bible. It's also a mandate for those who call themselves Christians. Let's take real quickly in the remaining minutes of 3 different areas that the Scriptures show God's hospitality for the poor. The first is one of deliverance. At critical moments in human history, the Creator of heaven and earth is revealed as a great deliverer. Decisive moments of need, God takes sides and doesn't, as we read in Psalm 9:12, ignore the cries of the afflicted. When the oppressed migrant or the homeless cry out to God, He hears, He sees, and He delivers. He often provides deliverance through compassionate hospitality of those who truly love Him. The second thing we see in the Scriptures is justice, and that is God is concerned about social justice. During the time of political security and economic prosperity, God sent Amos to the northern kingdom of Israel to condemn those who oppress the poor and crush the needy, as Amos chapter 4:1 brings out. He said, let justice roll down like waters and righteousness as a mighty stream, Amos 5:24. Isaiah 1:17, believers are told to seek justice, encourage the oppressed, defend the cause of the fatherless, and plead the cause of the widow. The third thing we see is equality. We see that God desires the equal distribution of material resources. In this time of extreme capitalism, as the rich are getting richer and the poor are getting poorer, we got to realize that God delights in exalting the humble and casting down the rich and the powerful. Mary speaks of this in Luke chapter 1, verse 52 and 53, when she declared, He has brought down rulers from their thrones, but have lifted up the humble. He's fulfilled the hungry with good things, but has sent the rich away empty. A holistic ministry is concerned about the physical, the mental, and the spiritual needs of individuals, and freedom coming through the grace of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, to all people, including the strangers in a strange land. Jesus says in John 10:10, I've come to that they might be full. He says, I've come that they might be full. I've come to meet their needs. This doesn't just mean money for the elite prosperity people. This means that all people, those that have truly received Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior, see that every dollar they have is a gift from God, and they need to use it for the glory of God. Jesus was the heartfelt person that came upon this earth and shows God's love for the poor and downtrodden. As followers of Jesus Christ, we can do no less. We have to be willing to serve Him in spite of the political consequences, in spite of what people might say about us. We're willing to reach out to the strangers in a strange land, obeying the mandates of Scripture. Let's go to Him in prayer. Father God, we come to You and we confess often our indifference, Lord God, to the poor, the homeless, the refugee, the migrant. Oh God, help us to be Your voice of justice, Lord God. Lord, why should we sit back and remain silent when those that do not necessarily profess faith show more compassion than those who say that they're followers of Yours? Forgive us, Lord Jesus, for our political allegiance to political powers that are so contrary to the Scriptures. Help us, Almighty God, to allow You to be number one in our life. We want to surrender our lives to You, Christ Jesus. We ask You to forgive us for our sins of indifference, bitterness, hostility, and even hatred toward the least of these. Oh, Jesus, have mercy on our soul. For someday we know You're going to ask us, when You were hungry, did we feed You? Naked, did we clothe You? Sick or in prison, did we visit You? A stranger, homeless, did we welcome You? We want to say yes, Lord. And so we come to You at this hour, surrendering ourselves to You, asking You to be Lord of our lives. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
As Reverend Larry Rice and the staff of NLEC ask Jesus Christ to strengthen them through the power of the Holy Spirit, you also can do the same. If you've never committed your life to Jesus Christ, you can do that now. Just ask Him to forgive you for all of your sins and to be your Lord and Savior.